So we are in session 6, and in this session we will cover types of JIT compilers, computer memory basics, and .NET type categories such as value, reference, and pointers, boxing and unboxing, .NET primitive data types, what is a class type, string versus string builder. Walk through the MS Scottlib once again and look into all the different namespaces we have in that and C# literals, so what they are and how can we use them in your day-to-day programming. And lastly, we'll see enums as well. So we were talking about the JIT compilers in the previous session, wherein the CLR is going to make use of the JIT compiler. We also have discussed that what are the implications with the JIT compiler because of the runtime on-demand compilation. It results in a performance issues at the startup time, when the program is started at the first time and made use of the respective functionality, it's going to respond slow at the first time. So subsequent calls to the same method or same program will not give you the slowness. So this is a part of the JIT compiler's role, and to optimize this slowness, there are types of JITs optimized to given situation available, which we are going to see today as a continuation. And also, as part of that is the pre-JIT compilers are available, which does the complete source code compilation to the bytecode at the time of a deployment itself, which will eliminate the on-demand or on just-in-time compilation when the code is going to execute. So once you have the entire source code converted to a bytecode and deployed, so there will not be any startup delays anymore. So that's the nature of a pre-JIT compilers. So if you see the bottommost one, the engine is the Microsoft provided native image generator, which is type of a pre-JIT compiler, so wherein the entire .NET codes can be compiled to a native code and deployed to the respective servers. So from .NET Framework 2.0 onwards, the .NET built-in libraries, which are in other words referred to as a code, the base class libraries are pre-compiled and available using the engine, so that you know the runtime, whoever is making use of those core base class libraries, need not have to compile at the runtime again. And the next is the EconoJIT, which is similar except similar to the normal JIT, except that this is not going to retain the compiled methods in the memory for a longer time. So whichever it's going to optimizes to the usage of the memory area, wherein once the code block is compiled to the native code and placed in the memory, based on its usage, it's going to keep it or remove it from the memory during the execution time. So that's an EconoJIT, which is more economical to the memory area. So this is more useful for the memory intensive devices, or in other words, the smart client devices, wherein the available memory is limited and it optimally utilizes the memory during the execution of the program. The next one is what we had discussed, which is a normal JIT, which compiles the respective code blocks on demand whenever the execution point is reached, and the compiled native code is going to be in the memory area till the application is terminated. So so this is the difference between the EconoJIT and the normal JIT. So we are good with the JIT compilers part. Okay, so the topics for today, we're going to cover the data types. We'll get into the some of the, again, the primitive data types, and some of, we'll just start getting into the coding from now onwards. We have pretty much covered most of the basics so far, and the fundamentals aspects, and from today onwards we'll see more of a coding. Okay, so this is so I was just wondering to check with from where to start with the memory aspects and the coding side. So this is some kind of information that you, most of you might already know. They have the number system is used in the .NET, in the normal computer science for handling the memory. So this is pretty much the memory units slide that's showing the decimal versus the binary comparison. And of course, this is one of the very basic information, and this is part of the fundamentals, and again, that's the reason I'm just showing it up again. So most of you are already aware of this, and just going to be just a refresh on that again. So the decimal and the binary, the two number systems which we normally refer to in programming world, and there are two more, which is a hexadecimal as well, and the base 8 or base 16. On, so binary is a base 2, and decimal is a base 10. So the distinction between the decimal and the binary, as we see, it's a base 10 and base 2. And why base 10 and why base 2 is a question. So base 10 is pretty much the number system that used in our normal day-to-day life. If you see 10, 20, 50, 60, so these are all the base numbers. If you see 100,000 or million and so on, so those are the number system which we normally use in a day-to-day, which is more human-friendly number system. But when it comes to the computer's internal memory area, so this decimal number system is no more good. Why? We'll see in the next slides. So it pretty much uses the base 2 number system, which is the binary number system. And why? We'll see in the following slides. Okay, so just wanted to give you some kind of details about the how the memory is, the units of the memory are, and why do we need to do this way. So the units, if you see on the right-hand side, the first one is a kilobyte, which starts with the 1024 bytes. If you see, 1024 bytes, it becomes 1 kilobyte. Similarly, 1024, and why 1024 and not 1000? So that goes back to the number system. Okay, so 10 to the 2 to the power of 10 is 1024. If you see, 10 to the power of 3 is actually 1000. So 10 into 10 into 10 is 1000, and 1000 is normally in decimal number system is referred to as a kilo. Okay, 1000 grams or is a kilo, and in when it comes to the computer science, it's all base 2, so it's 2 power 10. 2 power 10 is translated to 1024, as a, this is a decimal value of 1024 bytes. Okay, so that's the base number. If you see, if you refer to any measurements of units going forward, so if you say 1024 bytes become 1 KB and 1024 kilobytes becomes 1 megabyte, 1024 megabytes become 1 gigabytes, and 1024 gigabytes become terabyte, and so on. So far we have seen this term in the memory area. Memory, we haven't come to petabyte, exabyte, zettabyte, and yottabyte. So there are probably, we might see them or hear them in commercial applications pretty soon, probably. So this is an overview of the binary versus the decimal number system, and why it is important. We'll see once we get into the .NET data types. So okay, so this is what it talks about. So the decimal number system is base 10, and 1000 is, in other words, a human understandable number is a decimal number system, not the binary number system. And that's the reason we again converted the 2 power 10 to 1024 to make a unit of 1 KB unit. So 1024 is the decimal conversion of 2 power 10. Okay, so how it is converted, it's basic math, which is a factor applying the 2 into 2 into 2, so on, and 2 power 10 becomes 1024 bytes. Okay, so now the next question comes, if you see on the top, we see 4 bits is termed as a 1 nibble, and 8 bits becomes a 1 byte, or in other words called an octet. So octet is again a synonym for byte, wherever both these terms collide with each other, so they are used in place of the other. So most commonly used is a byte word, otherwise octet is also referred to as 8 bits. So now the question comes is, what is a bit and a byte? So it's another way we're going back into the basics again. So a bit of information, it's a binary digit, okay, a 0 or 1 is a bit. So a bit can store either 0 or 1. So if you see, there are only 2 values a bit can have. So that's the reason the binary number system becomes important in the computers or in electronics normally. So the bit is a binary digit and the smallest increment of data on the computer. A bit can hold only one of the 2 values, which is 0 for off and 1 for on. If you refer to the day-to-day usage of the simple switch, in other words, so it can either have on or off, and there is nothing called intermediate to it. So when the on is turn on, that means it has some power that is getting in, and it represents number 1, and if when there is no power, it represents number 0. So bit, in other terms, when you go to the internal memory management, so it refers to a flip-flop. If you have heard this in your engineering, then it's good. If you are not, then this is the single individual unit, in other words called the flip-flop or the latch, is a pretty small circuit using a couple of NOR gates here. So RS latch is one of the basic latch, and there are so many types of latches available or flip-flops available. So this circuitry is internal part of the memory components when it goes to the hardware, which can persist a state of a program. Persisting a state is nothing but holding 0 or 1 at runtime. So whenever a pulse of electricity passes through the to the flip-flop, it can persist that state in terms of as an information. So that's the reason, if you refer to the programming language, the bytecode, in other words, the native code is referred to as a bytecode, because the bytecode information is pretty much instructions laid out in terms of zeros and ones. Okay, so that is a FYI. Now we'll see the byte. So the byte is 8 bits of information is called a byte. So when you lay out such flip-flops, 8 flip-flops side by side, and assign no zeros to each of them, then it comes to a 0. Okay, so that's the 8 bits of information becoming a byte. And 1 byte of byte means it's pretty much, so each of the latch or each of the flip-flop can hold 0 or 1, so that means 2, base 2. And we have 8 such bits. So the value that a 1 byte can store is 2^8. Okay, so that's the translation. So 2^8 is what the max number a byte can store when compared to the latches. Okay, it's pretty much clear. So if you might have already gone through this number system, decimal system conversion in your college curriculum, so probably this would be a refresh to that again. So I'm just comparing to the number system versus the physical hardware components, how it is related and why it is so. So 2^8 becomes 256 because, so if you have zeros assigned to all of these 8 bits, then becomes 0. And when you assign all ones, it becomes the max value is 255. How this is converted to 255? So it is the calculation that we have here. So the calculation how we convert this is the basic math of converting the decimal to the the binary to the decimal value. So if you apply this math, what we see here, you will get 255 as the number. So in other words, when we talk about one byte, a byte can hold a number, a decimal equivalent number of 0 to 255. So that means it can hold up to 256 numbers. Of course, at a time, okay? At a given time, it can hold only 255 as a max number. That can be, of course, because it starts from 0, we can count it as a 256 as a max number, which refers to 2^8. Okay, so now the question starts. Why 8 bits is a question now. So why not 2 or 10? We know why it is base 2, because base 2 is represents the your flip-flop nature of holding either 0 or 1, either on or off. Okay, so we are clear with the base 2, why. But why is it 8 bits? Why it's not 2 bits of information or 10 bits of information, so that it can allow you to hold more and more. So this has a history of why 8 bits. People have started with the lower bits in the when the original computers were designed, and down the line the number has been increased. Even the ASCII character set when it was introduced, it is only 128 numbers were available in the character set. But 255 was one of the matured stage wherein the IBM has baselined this 8-bit of information to facilitate or provide the entire character set that a normal programming computers can process. So this is pretty much relates to the number of the character set information, which is 8-bit. So why do you need 255? So if you see this EBCDIC character set, which is the 8-bit character encoding introduced by the IBM for its use in mainframes and mid-range computers in sometime in 1950s. So this character set represents the values that you can have. If you see, it starts from 0 and the last number is a 255, and the character set contains information as such, the lowercase alphabets having certain numbers. 113 represents a small a, and similarly 177 represent a capital A, and a special set of special characters and set of placeholders as well. If you see, these placeholders represent some of the character sets, so that can be customized for any hardware devices such as printers or the electronic communicators that can be used. And also the control keys as well. If you see the DIL key is there, and if you have control key and insert key and so on. So this is a pretty very old character set, which is an 8-bit character set, and that's the reason the 8 bits is standardized, and there are legacy systems which has even 6 bits and 7 bits and so on. So when it comes to the byte, 8 bits were standardized to make things standard, so that people don't have a multiple set of bits of information available, so that you have the platform interchangeability possible if everyone follows the standard. Okay, so that's a little bit of our history back to why 2-bit, why base 2 you have, and why you have 8 bits of information as a standardized. Okay, and now after that, there are several sets of character sets introduced based on the capabilities of the various machines and so on. This is a quick list of available character sets. And the number 2 ASCII is the one that is more popular, which is introduced for, and this is only handles only 128 as a max, whereas the EBCDIC conventions are standardized to 8, so that it can accommodate up to 255 when it can small case and uppercase and so on, additional characters as well. And in addition to that, there are several ISO specific standards came into place to accommodate the culture specific characters for various languages throughout the world. So so even today, if you see the character set we have, even for 32-bit character sets are available to accommodate various languages in the world. So Unicode is another thing which is the standard encoding, character encoding, used for to represent any global global character set which can accommodate any character in the world or any languages in the world. So it can accommodate multilingual, in other words. So see, 8 bits is sufficient enough only to handle the English character set. So the other equivalent or different culture specific character sets were evolved over a period of time to accommodate that. So that's an FYI, and so we'll jump into the variables and the related memory concepts in down the lines, and we'll see how we relate this byte information and whenever we have a specific type of data type created. So every data type that you create in the .NET program is associated with its size. So it's important to know how much size a given data type can occupy to make use of the respective data type based on your situation. So every data type has its own pros and cons, and so you make sure that you use the right data type at a given situation. So that's the reason it's the background is important to have that how much size it occupies and what is impact on the system when you write a program. So we'll see the basic fundamentals again on the variable versus an object here. So the what is a variable? A variable is a chunk of memory in which we hold a value that can be read or written. So it's a placeholder in the memory area wherein you can put your value. So when you declare a variable, you normally want to have some value assigned to it, a specific type of value assigned to it. And the variable is the unit that you can use to hold that memory area during your program. So a variable is, this is a typical variable diagram wherein we have a three dimensions to it. Number one is the name. So the variable will have a name, and it has a type, and it has a value. So there are three main attributes are tied up to a variable. Okay, so in a couple of the previous sessions, I have demonstrated some of the code without giving any intro of this, and this is pretty much vanilla flavor. Anyone can get to it. If you say int I, when I say int I, so I is a type. I is a name of the variable, and the int is a type of the data type. And the value, whenever you say I is equal to 10, so I gets a value. In other words, we'll see it more in down the line. And compared to the object diagram, The object diagram is a rounded rectangle. So in the through the session, I'll be using these representations whenever we see a program and how the memory is managed whenever you write a small piece of code, and how the value type refers different from the reference type and so on. So this is just an intro to the diagram so that we're going to represent down the line. So the rounded edge rectangle on the right hand side represent the object diagram. So objects can contain the variables. So that's the difference. In this case, if we say var is equal to value, so this is nothing but it's having a containment relationship to some variable data. Okay, and this is the diagram that we're going to see for whenever we see objects. And we have gone through the detailed whole one day session of almost like a 2 hour session or more than that on garbage collection. And at that time we just discussed that we just talked about objects everywhere. And when we come to this here, so we'll see more of that difference between object and a variable. So the object diagram, typically you will see the type of the object and the value associated to it. Okay, and these are the type categories available in .NET programming. So one is a value type, the other one is a reference type. So which are the two keywords which we have been hearing in these sessions. And the third one is a pointer type, which we have seen in one of our unsafe code examples wherein we try to create a pointers code in a C# language. And of course, that's one of the reason again, and one of you have asked, when will you choose VB.NET versus C#.NET? And this is one of the reason again, when will you go for a C# versus VB.NET code? And I answered you that time saying that whenever you write a device programs which can interact with the hardware components and any plugins, a plugin components that you need to talk to. So C# is the programming language that you will choose, wherein the pointers concept is available to use in C#. Although .NET doesn't support pointers, you can write the pointers using an unsafe code. Okay, so using VB.NET you cannot do that. So pointer type is again limited only to the C# .NET code, wherein it refers to the point, the memory area, or in other words the memory address. But the difference between the pointer type and the reference type is very narrow actually. So the difference is that the garbage collector, whenever it comes into play, it can recognize only the reference types, and it doesn't care or can manage the pointers, because pointers are completely going out of the managed memory area. So the garbage collector cannot manage that pointers. So that's the basic difference. Otherwise, both reference type and pointer type are referred to an address location, and the variable that you're using, you can actually pass it to the other calling program to manage the given address location. And reference type is also pretty similar, wherein the whenever you make use of the variables, it always refers to the address area but not the value. Okay, so we'll see the difference in depth with the value type and the reference type now. So as we see in a variable that holds a value type, the data itself is directly contained within the memory allocated to the variable. So if you see int x is equal to 5, so as we see the three dimensions to it, the first one is the data type, which is int, and x is the identifier. Otherwise, it is the name of the variable and the value assigned to it. So, it's a three dimensions to to the variable. So, internally what happens is the value that you're assigning to a variable is actually contained within the variable. So in other words, when X sits in a 101 address area, the value also sits in the same memory area. So it doesn't sit in a somewhere else. So it's a its own private copy is maintained for a value type. When it comes to reference type, so reference type also make use of the value type. So in other words, it has a name called Y, object Y is equal to new object, and it's of type object, but the value of the this variable doesn't have the value of the object, which is instantiated. So it will have the address area of the object where it is resided in the memory. So that's a clear distinction between a value type and a reference type. So reference types usually refer to the address, whereas value type will contain the value within itself. Okay, so that's pretty clear definition, and this is again a very base important aspect in your programming life, in your career, and also in almost every interviews. Okay, so people will definitely ask you this question: what is the difference between a value type and reference type? Probably people might not ask you what is a pointer type. They might ask you pointer type only when they are really using that, and also if you are a very experienced resource they are looking for. Otherwise they won't go to the pointer type, but 100% they will ask you, 100%, note it, 100% they will ask you what is a value type and reference type. So make sure you understand this, and going forward, this becomes a very fundamental topic. So going forward, we will keep on saying the word reference type and value type, okay? So value type will contain the value within within its own address area. It is, whereas the reference type will have a reference to the address area where the value is stored, okay? So that's the fundamental difference. Okay, we'll see more what this mean and how this is going to be impacting your program. Okay, and we are good with the pointer type. I just started with the differentiating reference type was pointer type. I was eager to jump into pointer type rather than the value type and reference type. So the only difference between the pointer type and the reference type is that the with respect to the garbage collector, where the garbage collector can clean up the reference types. And also important point is garbage collector will look only for the reference types. If you remember, we have root nodes that are the root objects that a garbage collector looks for. Okay, the root objects are again objects, not value type. They are reference types. Okay, and also remember when the sweep algorithm comes into play, it looks for the heap, not for the stack. And what is a heap and what is a stack? We didn't talk about the differences, we'll see that now, okay? So the value type and the reference type, so value types get into the stack, whereas the reference types get into the heap. And now what is a stack and what is a heap? So a stack is pretty much an array of memory. It is a LIFO, that means last in, first out. So whenever a value is added to the stack, it is called a push, and whenever you take it out, it's called a pop. So this is much internals of a stack, how it is different from a heap. Okay, just want to differentiate that. We are not going to cover the data structures in our sessions. Just to have a differentiation, what is a stack and what is a heap, and which one is better in which scenario. This will give you some overview. So as you see, stack is a very lightweight. In other words, if you see, it's a last in first out operation wherein the values gets in a memory location and it all adds up to the given memory location, and the values will stack on one on the other, and whenever you retrieve it, it's going to be using a pop mechanism to retrieve the value back. So stack, when you say value types, are pretty lightweight and small in nature. So whenever you're dealing with a small values, they all treated as a value type. So it's important to remember this thing. In other words, plain vanilla, make just as a thumb rule, just refer a value type to a small and a reference type to be big. Okay, in other that will help you to decide which variable you're going to use down the line when we go and start doing some programming. So reference types, in other hand, is going to use a heap memory location. So heap is quite big, big in size, and it refers to more. If you have ever seen the defragmentation in your computer, when you run a defragmentation, in fact, we have seen a lot about heap when we discussed about the garbage collection in depth. And we have referred to it with kind of a graphics view of how the objects are placed in the memory and how they are compacted. Well, when the compaction happens, how they are moved from one address to another address. And so the diagram that the picture that I have here shows you the same thing. So see, the heap is quite big, and whenever you create an object, you can actually go and create anywhere, wherever is available, wherever the memory area is available. So in this case, in this picture, if you see, it's kind of a defragmented memory store. So it is big in size, and also it is very fast to use as well. And since it is big in size, the automatic garbage collection is added up to it, which is called a garbage collector. Whereas stack is not managed by the garbage collector. Garbage collector will not be responsible to cleaning up the stack. And also, you also don't need to worry about cleaning up the stack. The internal, the operating system itself manages the stack. So whenever a program executes and make use of a memory area, it's going to clean up that memory area whenever the program gets terminated and goes out of reach, out of the process. So whenever you kill the process, the operating system will clean up the stack area. So when it comes to GC, so GC is more controlled mechanism, because objects, based on the nature of the object, so there are a lot of implications added to the object in terms of the size they occupy, and also the kind of implementation that goes into an object, because there will be a lot of relationships between one object to the other objects. That's the reason it's called a reference type again. So one object can refer to another object in multiple ways. You'll understand much better when we get into the object-oriented programming. So all the object-oriented programming, in other words, is again, if the name implies, it's object-oriented, so it's completely related to the objects, so which are completely applicable only to the reference types and not the value types. Okay, we'll see more of the differences in the following slides. And the value type, and how you instantiate a value type. So since we see value types of in stack, and they are very small in nature, right? So you don't need to have a new constructor here, which is another word called. We have already seen what is a constructor and finalizer. So the value types doesn't contain any constructors in general. Okay, so in the VB.NET code example, it's dim I as integer is equal to 5 is the syntax to create a variable and initialize that with a value. So it's pretty much the identifier I, which is the name of the variable, and the type of the variable, and the value of the variable. We have all the three dimensions to it. And similarly, in C#, we have seen int I is equal to 5, and this is the basic syntax of how you can instantiate or create a variable of type value type variables, which is a data type space identifier is equal to value. So this is a syntax for a C# program. And similarly for object types, how you instantiate is used by the new operator. So you have to use a new operator to create an instance of an object, whereas it is not required when it is in a value type. While it is not required in a value type, again, that statement will undergo a change when we talk about these structures. Okay, so we'll see down the line. So we are good with this. This is pretty much again a straightforward thing, and most of you already know, and we have already seen programs written initializing creating instance of this when we did the Hello World program. Okay, so if you have any questions, please write it down. I will answer them at the end of the session. Okay, and so this is a slide that is trying to explain the immutable and mutable properties of a value type or a reference type. So what is immutable and mutable? If you have ever heard of the word mutation, mutation in general means change. Okay, to keep it simple, whenever you change something, you're actually you name it as a mutable. So values that can be changed are called mutable, and whichever you cannot change is termed as a immutable. So what does this mean? This mean is that the value types are immutable in nature with respect to the memory area. So in this example, I have an int x is equal to 5 and int a is equal to x. Okay, so when I have this value assigned to x, it doesn't mean that I can never change the value x. So I can still go and assign x to 10, and x will refer to 10. Okay, so what this means is whenever you refer one variable to another variable, in this case the second statement says that a is equal to x. In other words, you're actually assigning the value of x to a. So how our diagram looks like, you have a x with a value 5 and a with the value 5. So both have the same value, but the key thing important here is both have their own values, so they are not referred to one another. So x has its own copy and a has its own copy. Okay, even though the second statement says that a is equal to 5, it's actually copying only the value to it but not a reference to it, which is the key difference between the reference types. So that indicates that if I change a value of a down the line, only the a value will be changed, not the x value. So that means it is immutable. So I hope that is clear. So immutable means that, so it doesn't mean that x value can never be changed. Okay, so it means that whenever the values are referred this way, their values will have their own values, a copy of their values, but they will not be referred to one another. Because 5 is common, it doesn't mean a 5 is shared between both, okay, which is in case of reference types. So whenever reference type comes into play, in this case object y is equal to new object, we have y has a new instance of the object, and object b is, which is a separate variable, I'm assigning that b is equal to y. Okay, when that happens, that means y and b were actually referring to a object which is shared in one area. So if you remember the first diagram of the reference diagram, wherein the object diagram was actually having a value type which has a pointer, I mean which has a reference to another address address in the memory where the object is initialized. And when I say b is equal to y, so b actually copied the address of that variable, so that it refers to the same address place of the object in the memory. So this means if I change value of b or value of y, they both are referring to the common area, so the value will be changed and that will be reflected to both of the variables. So this indicates that the values of a reference type are mutable. Okay, that's clear. So we'll see this using a demo. Okay, this is the code that I already have in place to save our time. First, we'll see the value types, and then we'll go back to the reference types. Okay, so in this example, we have the same code that we have on the slide, wherein we have x having a value 5, and a variable a is referring to x. So in this case, the first line says before change, I'm just writing down the x and a values, and immediately after that, I'm changing the value of x to 15, whereas the value of this to 15, and I'm not touching the value of a. Okay, so the next immediate statement I'm writing is after the change, I'm writing the x and a. So based on the discussion we had that the value types are immutable, that means x and a have their own copy of the value, so they are not sharing it. So at the end of the this statement will show you, should show you x having 15 because x value has changed, and a as 5 because a is, when this statement comes, a copied the value of x, which is 5. Okay, there are some build errors. Let me fix that. Okay, so this need to go away. So I have multiple programs. Okay, so this is good now. Let me open this and this. So we'll see so the difference here. So this indicates the value types are not mutable. So A has the old copy of X, so the value got copied. And when the X value is changed, only X reflects the change but not the A. So this means the values are not are immutable when it comes to value types. And there, this basic difference between value type and reference type will change when we do the object code. So in this case, B and Y are actually referring to the same address. Okay, if I go back to the slide. So this case we have seen both have a different copies, and in this case when I say B is equal to Y, both are referring to the same address. Okay. Okay, so the conversion of value type to reference type is called a boxing, and the other way around is a unboxing. So in other words, what will happen here is the copy of the data from the stack is copied to a heap when the boxing happens. So, and when unboxing happens, it's going to do the reverse. It's going to take the copy of the heap from the heap to the stack, and in this conversion, what happens is the values that are moved from heap to stack, the value will go for a garbage. And so more of the times you do the boxing and unboxing, what happens internally is you create more overhead to the processing because you're switching from one type of memory allocation to another type of memory allocation, which is again expensive, and also you're resulting in creating the lot of garbage. So hence, it is not recommended to have a boxing and SLU. So we'll see the real example when we have a when we have a class created as user-defined member, and then refer to it using when we see that examples. We'll see more of the basic definition of a reference type versus the value type. Okay. And so this is another example wherein the implicit boxing happening. So wherein so the implicit conversion of a data type can happen because, as I said, all the data types in the .NET can be converted to of type object, because that becomes as the mother of everyone in the .NET. So the object is again referred to as system.object, wherein it is available in the system's namespace. Okay, so we'll see this in this demo. We'll see the similar effect what we have seen so far, wherein this show value is a method that is taking a variable of type, a parameter of type object, and we're trying to write that object to the console. And because it is object, this is mother of all data types, I can pass any data type into it. So it is, in this case, I'm passing an integer, and in the other case, I'm passing a float, and in the other case, I'm passing a string. In the third, fourth case, I'm passing an object itself, OBJ. So what it's returning, in the first case, it didn't complain. When I do a write line, it doesn't complain because the write line itself can take an object. But since the object has a respective data type, so that I passed in, this value is converted to a reference type when it is passed in, and it is utilized by the write line. And similarly, there is a implicit conversion happening in the code example that we are seeing here. So we'll just demonstrate this also. So this is another example that we have just seen. So I just have to comment this out, otherwise it's going to complain. As you remember, we cannot have more than one main methods in a program, because that's the entry point. So this won't be necessary here. Okay, I don't need this as well. Oops, sorry, my bad. So I wanted to show two different things. We're going to see the explicit conversion versus the implicit conversion. Okay, let me finish the explicit conversion, then we'll come back to the implicit one. So this one, the first block of code will demonstrate the explicit conversion of value type to a reference type. So in this case, the integer type, and this is a reference type. And y is an object, and I'm trying to assign the 5 to y, and in this case I'm having y is equal to object of x. This is actually pretty much converting x, which is a value type in int, to an object type and assigning it to y. Okay, and in the other case, I'm doing the reverse of that. I'm converting this y to a value type, which is int, and assigning it to x. So this is an explicit conversion of a value type to a reference type. Okay, so this is what we see. So although y is short phi and x is good phi, internally what happened here is we converted y to int type, object type here, and here we convert it to value type here. So this is an explicit conversion of values, and wherein the boxing effect took place. And so since you have control of converting it, the application does it implicitly as well without your notice in certain cases, which we have already seen one of the example wherein the effect of the reference types is lost because of the boxing and unboxing. And in this case, okay, I don't need the, okay, I will comment this out. I have too many. So in this case, the boxing is taking place without my knowledge, because this method is taking a parameter of type object, and I'm just making use of that member to pass any type of data to it, because it's taking object and it's mother of all data types in the .NET program. So I can pass any data type to it, so integer, float, string, and object of its own. So what internally happens is it's going to convert the value to a object type. So similarly, it's whatever we've seen, it's going to convert the integer to an object type. Similarly, it's going to convert it implicitly and execute the program. Okay, so that's the demo for the boxing and unboxing. So it's pretty straightforward. If any one of you have difficulty with that, let me know. Okay, so this is what we have seen, the code with the boxing, explicit conversion and implicit conversion of value to reference type. And here comes the primitive data type chart or tree view of the various data types that are available. So the primitive data types are predefined data types. That means the data types that are available within the .NET framework base class library. So these are readily available for you to make use of it. And out of them, we have seen some of them, which is object we have seen, and we have seen integer, and there are many other data types that are available in the system. So if you see the root of the classification, we have a predefined data types, we have a reference types, and the reference types are object and string. Okay, string is again a primitive data type, which we have seen, which is this. So within double quotes, whatever you have is a string, and object we have seen now. Okay, so these are the two reference types that we have here. But there is a distinction between how the string is. String is a little different from the rest of the reference types, wherein the string behaves like a value type, although it's a reference type. Okay, so this is the two reference reference types that are available in the primitive. And the value types are again grouped into structure types and the enumerations. And within that we have a simple types. So if you see, a little surprising here is all the primitive data types we see are of type structures. Okay. So we'll see from the MSI from the MSIL code of the MS Core lib. If you have remember, we have seen already verified that MS Core lib is the base core library that is referred to your projects, and it's available. And within that, all your data types are available. Okay, that's why it is one of the core libraries. And all of these data types, like a bool or numeric types or any of the int, uint, long, all of these types are of type structure. Okay, and saying that, so structures are value type. And within the structures, you have a simple types, which are primitive types. Again, bool stands for boolean, which can take true or false, and the next one is a numeric types, and all other term numerics, like decimal is a numeric which can take a large number. We'll see the another following charts, variable size each of them can accommodate, and the floating point types, which is float and double, and integers are again I have bytes, s bytes, and we'll see all of these in the next slides. And so this is the primitive data types in detail, wherein we have a comparison between the VB.NET data types and the C# data types. In C#, so this is actually the effect of capitalization of uh, So this is supposed to be small b. Oh, it's capitalizing anyway. Okay, for I have to ignore that from the settings. For now, just ignore that it's not capital B, it is a small b. Okay, and yeah, so on. So the boolean is the data type in VB.NET and C#, equivalent is bool. And the common type system, if you see, we have seen that once you have these two data types, the MSIL will emit system.boolean, and its size is 2 bytes of space, which takes two values of only two values, which is true or false. Okay, the least memory that you can choose is 1 byte, which is going to be this. In this case, is a sign byte, where it has a plus and minus. In other cases, it does. There is a unsigned byte as well, which will take only positive integers. So the char is the next, which is again you can use the char data type to hold characters, and that's how the name implies. And how to hold the characters, we'll see. There's a special notation to pass for this data type to hold characters. And when will you use what? So which one is going to be used, and based on your need, you're going to decide which one you want to use. So char can take only 2 bytes, which is less, and it can hold single characters again within the its data type. And the data time is 8 bytes, which is a very big data type, in other words. So if you see, 8 bytes is for a long whose range is so big, I can't even read it. Probably it's a petabyte or utabytes kind of thing. So it's a number is so huge. So 8 bytes is used for date time data type, and so relatively, of course, you will need to use date time to hold very large data. Its range is almost from Jan 1st of 1 year 1 to 9999, which can accommodate any given year. S byte is a signed byte, which will take which is a numeric data type. Of course, the char also should fall under the numeric data types. I just kept it outside deliberately to just differentiate. Otherwise, the char is surprisingly a numeric data type. The older version of Excel, which is 2003, it has a limit of the same number, which is 65535, and max number of rows it can accommodate in a given sheet. So the limit is also reflects back to this data type size. That means the number of rows the row number that can be accommodated in a spreadsheet is of type size 2 bytes. That's the reason that number restriction is available. And in the recent versions of spreadsheet, it accommodates up to 1 million or more. So that restriction is gone. Okay, so the S byte is a signed byte, wherein it can take minus to 128 to 127. It's a negation and positive. It can take both the positive and negative numbers. And the another slide, we have the here we have the byte information, which is a positive value, which is 0 to 255, which we started with. Okay, and short is of 2 bytes of information. It is of integer type. Integer and long, these are all numeric types, which doesn't take a precision points. You can have only numbers to it. So for operations like money and other things, you cannot use this value because this will not give you decimal points. And integer has 4 bytes and it can go up there, and long has 8 bytes, which is very larger. And based on this, you can actually decide which one you're going to use based on your scenario. Okay, and also remember that we have discussed that the size of the class, if it exceeds 85K, it treated as a special class in the memory by the garbage collection to treat it as a large object and place it in a large object heap. So the calculation, that math you're going to use to calculate your size of your class, reflects to the data types that you're using within the class and their size and how much size they can take up. Okay, so this math also applies to that. So the next slide shows the precision data types, which are going to be useful when we're doing scientific calculations or a money kind of operations, wherein you need the decimal point, like a division of two numbers can result to a decimal points, and these are the various data types available to handle that situations. The first one is a single, which takes 4 bytes of information, 4 bytes of size. And a double is 8 bytes in size, and the largest available data type is the decimal, which takes up to 16 bytes of data, and then you need to be wisely using this data type, because this is very big in size and also has a very large scope to it. So this is mostly used only for the scientific operations, wherein the precision is up to 20, it supports up to 28 places of decimal point, and the smallest is a non-zero number. It can go to a very large number. If you see the smallest number, I don't have words to describe this number, but it is very, very small. It goes probably beyond nano size. So the decimals is more scientific operations you're going to use, and even for banking operations, it will be too big. So probably double should be good enough for handling even money kind of operations. Okay, and this special type of data type we have seen, a system.object, in our demo. This is a special type of object, as we discussed. This is an ultimate base class for all classes in the .NET framework, all the data types in the .NET family refers to object one way or the other. So it becomes the mother of all the data types. So it has couple of basic 4 members that are available for object, and those 4 members are also available with any other data type that inherits or from the object data type. And so that we see the part of the inheritance when we see the object-oriented programming, and here the 4 important members are the equals that we can use to specify if the current object, which is OBJ, is equal to any other object in the program. So if you have multiple OBJs here, objects or multiple data types here, if you want to check if both are equal, you can use this member. And also get hash code. Hash code is an interesting one, which is a numeric value, which is internally used by the object algorithm to differentiate if the 2 objects are equal. So it's likely to give you a unique value for each of the object instance, but it is not guaranteed. Okay, so for uniqueness, you have to have your own algorithm or override and implement of this hash code member. To write your own algorithm to give a unique value whenever you use, and you can use that when you add multiple objects to a collection and differentiate each of the objects with a unique ID. If you want to have such kind of implementation, you can use the get hash code. And get type gives you the type of the current instance. In this case, the type of the object is a system.object. And toString gives you the string representation of the current object, which is the system.object again. So in a program, if you see, if you read out the values that you see for these 2 objects, obj1 and obj2, and I'm trying to use the equals member method here, object1 dot equals object2, because there are 2 different objects created. They both are not referring to one another, so that's why they are not equal. So it says false. And if I say obj1 is equal to obj2, then according to my definition, it should the equals should result to true. Okay, we'll see that quickly. That shouldn't take much time. Okay, comment this out, and I will also comment this out. Oops. Comment this out. I'm going to have another variable of type X. Okay, so both have two separate instances, and I'm going to write line. I'm going to say x dot equals, okay, and I'm passing, oh sorry, y dot equal, I'm passing x to it. Okay, and in the next immediate statement I will say y is equal to x. So according to my original definition, that both refers to the same address place, so both should be equal. So now I will try to get that, okay? And to differentiate, we'll say before and after. So the expectations from this code is that in this case both have a different address space addresses, and now in this will bring them to point to only one address, and in which case this should be true. Okay, I just have to get rid of this. Because it's complaining that I'm having multiple mains, so it doesn't allow. Okay, it's gone. Okay, so as expected, we see before it is false and after it is true. So that indicates that equals is matching, because both of these objects are actually referring to the same address, and hence the evaluation turned true. The slide that shows the data types hierarchy. As we have been seeing, that all the data types in the .NET family are inherited or derived from the ultimate base object called the system.object. So this is the ultimate type that all the value types, even the value types and the reference types, are all inherited from. Again, so this leads to one of the big question, that if value types or the structures, in other words, or value types in general, do not participate in inheritance hierarchy. So, but we see that all the value types as well inherit from the system.object when system.object itself is of a reference type. So in normal inheritance hierarchy, if they normally inherit, they normally get those benefits. So that means, in other words, they will inherit all the properties and behaviors of the base class members. In this case, it's not, when we see the basic difference between a value types and a reference type, it's not that way. So value types will definitely handle in a different way, and the reference type handle in a different way completely. But if you see the data types hierarchy in .NET, so it's a little surprising that there is something called a system.value type, which again inherits from system.object. But the system.value type will actually override all those base behavior of a system.object, but keeping all the other value types behave like a value types that we have been talking about so far. And to quickly demonstrate this, the best place I would like to go to is the ILDASM and see the mscorlib, wherein that's the place where we can actually see how this has been referred to. So I'm going to open the mscorlib, wherein all the base data types are available. Again, MS CoreLibre has a specific to the respective .NET framework version. In this case, I'm referring to the 4.0 framework version. It really doesn't matter. So whichever framework version we pick, the base data types are still going to be the same. And MS CoreLib, this is the DLL. That's the core DLL that we normally refer to. And this is again a important thing that I referred to this in several occasions. This is the DLL that is referred in the .NET program by default. And without this, you cannot actually have any project. And you don't do it manually. It's done implicitly. So if you see any projects you create, you don't see an MS CoreLib referred in the solution, but implicitly that's a runtime based library which is referred to. Inside this, if we want drill down to the system's namespace, and you'll see all these base data types that we have been talking. If you take a look at the system.object to start with, we can go with the system.object. I think I've just passed it. Yeah, here I go. So this is a system.object, and if you take a look at this, this is the base data type that all the data types in .NET derive from. And this doesn't derive from anything else. This is the base data type. So this is again a fundamental question people do ask, which is the base data type that's, or in other words, base class for all the data types, and this is system.object, so that's an ultimate answer. In other words, it's referred to as an ultimate base class in the .NET data type library. Okay, and we've been talking about the system.value type. Let's go to the value type again. We should be somewhere down. Yep, here you go. So this is a value type, and again, so this is a this does have a constructor, so this also behaves like a class again. So this is actually extending extend system.object. If you take a close look at this, so when it says extends, that means it's actually inheriting from system.object. And so this is one in key information that you would like to know. And that's how, if you take a look at the slide that I have we have seen. So all these members like equals, get hash code, get type, toString. So these are the members of an system.object, and they are available for all the value types as well in the .NET family, and that's because of that inheritance hierarchy. Okay, so that's how the system, the base data types have been structured to have their commonality. And also in one of the code that we have seen when we pass in the function that has a parameter of type object, and we're able to pass the other value types to it, and it's been taking it, and that's how it is possible that our value types can be implicitly casted to the reference type. That's how the boxing and unboxing normally takes place. And let's take a quick look at the other data type called system.int32, and int should be here. So similarly, like int 32, we have int 16, 64, and int ptr. Again, int ptr is a different thing altogether, which doesn't have an alias. So we'll see alias again, what is an alias, in the next slide. If you take an int 32 here, we'll take close jump, and if you take a close look at this, this extends the value type. And again, in 32 we know that it's a value type, and value types are defined that way. And again, another one is a boolean similarly. So if you take a look at the one by one to all the value types, they all inherit from the system.value type, and system.value type internally inherits from system.object. But this is a value types are completely treated differently than the reference types. So that's the implicit definition. Okay, this is the last one that I would like to show. And booleans. Booleans also do extend from system.value type. Okay. And that's how I would like to Take a close look at this. And also a couple of these are on the right hand side, if you see, these are the couple of base classes that are available which has a special meaning in the .NET programming. One is the System.Array. So arrays are, we're going to see that in the probably in the next slide down the line. Probably no, I don't have a separate slide for that, but I will walk through right now. So System.Arrays are the one which are going to be used for collections. So we're going to walk through the different types of arrays. We have a single dimension, multi-dimension arrays, or jagged arrays you can create. So all these collection-based operations you can do, data types with handles a collection of different data types that can be done using System.Array. So it's one of the main class in which it's again, it's a bottom line, it inherits from the System.Object. And again, the System.String is again a very special class. As I've been saying that this is a reference type because it's actually directly inheriting from System.Object, but it this one behaves like a value type, wherein it is an immutable. So this is again a very important question people do ask, what is a difference between a string, how the string behaves, and why is it immutable or immutable? So we'll see that in quickly in the next few minutes. And a delegate is another very important base class available. This is useful for handling the delegates wherein the events are triggered. This is, in other words, if you refer to the C++ program one, this refers to the concept of a pointers. So to satisfy the need of a pointers in .NET languages, the delegate is introduced. So delegates is similar to pointers, but it's not exactly the same. It's much richer than pointers. And system.delegate will have a mapping or reference to a function at runtime, in other words, to an address of a function rather than the function itself. And you can associate any function across at runtime. It doesn't matter in which class it is. As long as the function is available in memory, you can delegate to a delegate. In other words, you can associate that to a delegate and invoke it at any time in the runtime. So it's, in other words, it's pointing to the address, but within the safe way. Using delegate, it's not an unsafe way, but of course, using pointers, it's an unsafe way. And that's one of the, again, key class we see here. And system.exception is, again, a very important class. So it's especially, we'll see that more when we deal with these exception handling. And another key thing that you might normally see, and you might ask yourself, have another, if I just add another class here in this project, okay, what you can see is I can type string, say for example st, string and string. So if you take a close, oops, I can't keep this, 1 to 2, okay, just give me a select, oops, you know, West Coast, I can't freeze it. The best way I can do is string, oops. Okay, kind of take the snapshot of it. Let me see if I can put it in a paintbrush. No way, forget it. So what I mean to say here is, if you see the IntelliSense, string, there are two strings if you see. One is with a small case, another one is with the capitalized. But both, if you take a close look at the IntelliSense pop-up here, both are nothing but system.string. In other words, I would like to show this way. str is equal to, say, some value, v string st is equal to, say, some value. Okay, and I'll say control.writeline str, and oops, I can't do a control write line here because I need to have uh, I need to have a static void main here within which I can say control write line to str, and okay, some typos, forget it. Okay, so running, writing a code at sessions is going to be a little tricky, although it's going to be a very simple code. We might end up with a lot of minor things. Okay, fine, no problem. This is again a simple, that's the reason I normally do all these samples well ahead and keep it ready to save a lot of time. Okay, in this case, what I'm trying to show here is the differences here. So both are strings, and if you notice it, one is with a capital S, another one is a small s. So what are these, if you ask? And really, if this code really runs, is there anything wrong with this code? Let me see. Okay. The problem is that it has another main here. That's the reason it's cribbing. I'm going to satisfy that error and quickly go back here. And if you see, it's compiled good, so there is no issue. And as I see, it builds succeeded. No issue with that. Okay. And I'll try to run this and see. And there is no issue with that. See, I get able to see print V, and I also able to see string. So what is this? Why is there, we see two different things here? Okay, so again, another way to go back to this is right click and say go to definition. And I land up in a sealed class called string. This is for capital S, right? Pay little close attention. And again, I'm going to the small case. S, and I do the same thing, go to definition, and it lands up to the same page where it is also under system, and it's a sealed string. Okay, so what is the difference between these two? Ideally, there is no difference at all. Whatever we're seeing in a small case, this is an alias in C# language, whereas string, what we're seeing here, is the .NET data type representing system.string. Implicitly, when str and st are represented in the MSIL, they both will be represented as a system.string. So this is the .NET data type that we are referring to in the metadata when we jumped in. Okay, and for C# language, string is a alias. That alias is referring to string dot system.string. So that's the only difference, in other words. Okay, and another way again here is, whenever we are making use of string, what is important here is that it's because it is coming from the system namespace. As we see, this is within the system namespace. Okay, so this is coming from the system namespace. So it's mandatory that you need to actually import the system's namespace. Otherwise, you can actually cannot use the other one. This you cannot use. String with capital, we cannot use. Okay, of course, when I take the system off, all the other lines are also broken because the console also comes from the system. Since we are trying to demonstrate the difference between the small s and capital S, so if you want to make use of the string, then you have to use the using statement for string. Okay, and of course, otherwise there is no difference between both the things. Both are stands good. I really the best recommendation with respect to the language wise, the recommendation is to use the strng with the small case, in which case you don't have to actually do the import the system namespace, and this is actually going to be taken care of with the MS Kotlin directly. Otherwise, the system.string is actually going to be coming from the system's namespace, wherein you have to import this library, which is system.dll. Okay, so this is again, so mskotlib has a mapping to the system.dll, wherein it will actually, this is a .NET data type. In other words, the only difference is this is a C# alias that refers to the .NET data type called system.string. Okay, so that's one thing I wanted to highlight here. Similarly, just like a string, all of the data types have their own alias again. So like system.object has an object similarly, and what else? In one of the CLS class, we did see the common type system wherein the int, for example, int in C# and or integer in VB.NET, both are represented as a system.int32. And similarly, if you take a close look at this, int is an alias that goes to in 32. System.int32 is the data type. And again, if you take a close look at this, this is again a structure. Okay, so this data type is a structure. So all these are, a structure is again a value type again, so needless to say. Okay, that's about the alias. If at all you ever wonder why there are two with a capital and small, so that's the reason. It's two separate things. And another important behavior of a string, we have been talking about a string as a special case altogether. And we'll see what is a special case altogether. So I have already written a code to demonstrate the strings. Okay, so this is the code sample. Let me build this up. Okay, so this program, in this case, if you take a close look, so we have a data type, string str created, and we have initialized with a string called hello. And what I'm trying to do here is I'm actually trying to build a string by adding words to it. So in this case, I'm actually concatenating str with the previous value and appending with the new value. That means in this case, it's going to append hello plus a word. And similarly, we're actually appending one new word to a string, and finally, we're actually printing this out. Okay, so let's run this code and see. And what we see here is, this complete sentence formation, right? Is there anything wrong with this code? If someone asks you, so yes, there is definitely a big thing here is whenever we make use of a string data type in this way, it's going to be very, very expensive. And why it is expensive, we'll see. So that's because of the immutable behavior of a string data type. What happens internally, let's take a look at this. So if you walk through the memory allocation, how it's for string especially, what happens here is whenever you declare a new variable, str is actually going to create a memory location in the first place and have the value saved into the value part. Okay, this is again because string itself is a reference type, the memory allocation happens in the heap. Okay, so heap is again a little bigger. And whenever I say string.string plus hello world, and what happens is it, instead of using the same old address, as we know that reference types normally refer to a given address, but for strings it's not that case. What it does is whenever it sees the value that has been assigned to the variable, if the value is not already existing, so internally strings have their own value table wherein they will store all the values within the value table, and each of the value table will have the respective memory reference. In other words, if you take one step down into the implementation part, so here I did not go that step down to keep it a little simple. And what happens is it's going to look up into the value table and see if the given value that's been assigned to it is existing in that value table or not. And if it is not there, then it's going to go ahead and create another memory location. In other words, go ahead and add it and that new value to the value table and create that new value in a given address. And that's how the mapping is going to be done. So now currently at this point, it's going to refer to that new address, which is called, in this case, 1002. Similarly, whenever we're going to add up a new, whenever we assign a new string to it, and if that given assigned value is not in the value table, then it's going to create a new address every time. But at the end, it's going to, of course, refer to the last one, which has been currently been referred to. So in this case, what we end up doing here is creating a lot of memory locations without our notice. And since the last one is actually whatever we see the output is the final output is hello world, how are you? That's the value that's been used. Rest all becomes garbage. So again, so this way, if we start using the way we have here, especially if you're doing an iteration and you're looping to a thousand times or 2,000 times, so you don't know how many times you're iterating based on a variable number of loops you're having. In that case, you're going to end up with a large garbage that you're going to create when you're using a string data type. And that's the reason strings need to be handled very carefully in .NET especially. So whenever you're trying to make use of a string, make sure that you're not doing any operations or iterative operations wherein you're trying to assign a different new value every time. Again, when it is useful here, because the nature in which they are designed to work, they normally look up to the value table and see if the value really exists there or not. If at all you're using the same value repeatedly across your application, then in that case, for example, like a constant, in those cases, it's going to be really useful. For example, you have employee record. Just an example, okay? It's not a practically applicable scenario, but just an example wherein an employee record has a department field wherein it can have a set of 4 or 5 departments, okay? And within your code, in the employee collection, if you say you have one million records, and for managing the departments with the 1 million records, what happens here is because the distinct values of the department is only 5, then you normally end up having only 5 values for that particular strings, whatever you're trying to use. In those scenarios, strings are very beneficial. Okay, so it normally does is it's going to reuse the same value which is already there in the value table. That's how the because as I said, whenever the assignment happens to a string, it's going to look up into the value table, and if it is there, then it's going to use the same value. Otherwise, it's going to actually go ahead and create a new memory location. So it's going to preserve the list of the values that have been assigned across these strings and see if any one of these values matching whenever any other string is using and try to reuse them. So it's optimal the way for scenarios that you choose, and it can be disastrous because of the nature if you choose it in the wrong way. Okay, in a typical case like this, where I'm sure that the values that have been assigned cannot be same all the time or most of the time, then the best alternative is to go with the string builder. Okay, so that's the string builder is the next thing we will see. And I want to show you also the next important behavior of a string. Keeping the same behavior, we'll see the immutability of a string. Again, we did see what is a mutable and immutable. So in this case, I have two strings, str1 and str2. And the str1 has a value called first, and str2 has a value called second. Okay, and I'm just trying to print this content saying before and adding up to this. I think I did not introduce you to these literals for now. I'm going to show you, probably I do have that as well as part of it. Yes, so literals are a little in the last. Anyway, since I'm already using literals here, don't worry about that. These are string literals, backslash n, backslash t, which we'll explain that later. For now, we're going to concentrate on the immutability of a string. Okay, so I have a string 1 and string 2, and first and second those are values that I assigned. In the before I do anything else, I'm actually printing those current values here, str1 and str2. Okay, and what I'm doing immediately is I'm actually assigning both together. We have just seen a value types in one of the code samples just a few minutes back, which is demonstrating the immutable nature of a value type. But remember, string is not a value type. String is a reference type, but it behaves like a value type because that's the reason we are actually making it a special case here, and also we did see why. And in this case, what I'm doing is str1 is assigned to str2, and in this case, because they are reference type, they should be referring to the same address. Okay, so in that case, if I change value of str1, then that value should also get reflected to str2. That's the normal behavior of reference types, wherein if both are referring to the same address, if that value at that given address is changed, then both should get reflected. But in case of string, what will happen? Let's see. So this is the output. And in the first case, before first and second, they're the initial values that came out as they were. And after str1 is equal to str2, which is in this case, when we are assigned both to each other, what happened here is, instead of actually referring to the same address with respect to string, the value is actually copied back. So in other words, the value address is copied rather than the object address. Okay, so what happens, the value of str2 is copied to str1. So that's when both actually showing the same address. And again, you cannot actually differentiate this step with the reference type as reference type also, because they will, if they both are pointing to the same address, they will both obviously going to show you the same value. So in this case, we cannot say whether it's actually value is copied or not. The third case will confirm that statement. So wherein, after changing the str1 to changed, what happened here is str1 value got changed, but str2 value did not change, although both are referring to the same address. So that's called the immutable nature of a string. So if strings are referring to one another, string types, although string is a reference type, does it inherit from a system.value type? No, it actually inherits from a system where it's inheriting from. Let's go back there. We'll see it in the Object Explorer, which will tell you. Otherwise, we can also go to, okay, I'm going to take that, get rid of this, system.string. So it's a sealed class string, and in other words, I can't see where it is inheriting from, but if I expand the base types, then I can see the object at the bottom. Okay, so using my Object Explorer, I can see that system.string is actually, the base type is object. That means it is a reference type, ideally speaking, but it behaves completely like a value type. And a string isn't immutable because it behaves like a value type. So that's the scenario demonstrated here. Okay, so that's good. And now what's an alternative for scenarios that we have been talking, like wherein we might have cases wherein we have to create, iterate through a list of strings and do a concatenation programmatically. In those kind of scenarios, you can actually make use of a string builder. Okay, so this is a code sample I have. It's the same example, but in this case, I'm making use of a string builder. Again, remember, string builder doesn't come in system namespace. It comes in system.text namespace. So that's the key thing. If I take this off, I hope the string builder should go away. Yep, the string builder is thrown away because it's coming from system.text namespace. It's not from system namespace. Okay, so string builder is again a class which comes with a lot of features built in with itself to manipulate strings. And one of the key thing here is the append. So it's not like concatenation that we use when we play with the system string builder. And if we, I would like to actually go and diagnose this into or look up more in detail of a string builder in the Object Explorer and see where it is inheriting from. What is its base type? Again, so string builder is a base type is system dot object, okay, and it's member of system dot text, okay. So that's the little details of a string builder. And now what I'm trying to do here is I'm actually adding values to it using an append method. And once I have done, I'm actually making a call of SB, which is string builder dot toString. So toString is going to actually read out the whole text the way I would like to see. And that's exactly, this is using string builder. The value is hello world, how are you? So the same thing. So in this case, what will happen here is this is completely a reference type. And this doesn't behave like a value type. This is a completely reference type. That means SB values are mutable. And we'll see how it is mutable. That means, in other words, irrespective of number of values that I added up here, it is not going to eat up a new memory location. So it's going to make use of the same memory location and going to behave just like a reference type. And to demonstrate that, we have another code sample here, which is going to, okay, I need the other one as well, okay, to have this demo. In other words, I want to keep the whole thing as is, okay, because in this case we are actually making use of both. So what this whole set of code is doing is we have a first SB whose value is written out. Okay, I'm going to take this off to keep it simple because I already have this write line statement here, SB2 toString, and SB2, I'm just adding only one value to it, which is new, okay, and SB2 is also written out, that is before, okay, and immediately after that, what I'm going to do is I'm referring both to the same address. In this case, both are referring to the same address as because they are reference types. Instead of now the value being copied, both should be referring to the given address. If that is correct, then if I change one of the variable here, one of the variable value here, saying that I'm appending a new value in addition to this value, because SP2 doesn't have a value like a new value, because we have added a value called hello world, how are you, and we are adding to SP as a new value. Okay, so in this case, what should happen if they are not referring to one another, like in the case of string, then SB should be listing me out the values hello world, how are you, and also new value. Okay, and SB2 in this case, the second statement should be giving me value only one, new. Okay, because I did not do anything. But let's see. Okay, so if you see, this is called mutable behavior. The first one is SB value is hello world, how are you, and this is before, and SB2 has a one value which is new. That's what we have here. And after assigning the SB2 to SB, we have the new value of SB to new, and also new value of SB2 to new, because both are referring to the same address. Again, as I said, at this point you cannot even say that either both are referring to the same address or the value of SB2 got copied to SB. We cannot say, because both in either way going to give you the same value out. Okay, so what makes a difference here is the afterwards, aftermath of appending a new value to SB. After appending the new value to SB, what happened here is both the values got changed. SB in this case, so I did put the correct right statement, SB.toString also had the new value, as SB.SB2 also had the same value. So what happened here is this is the behavior called mutable. So reference types are mutable, and this is an example that a string builder behaves as a reference type, and also it is a reference type, whereas a string behaves like a value type. And that's the key difference between both these data types, and it's need to be a thought process, need to go behind which one need to be chosen to do what. And also another important thing to keep in mind is because of the concatenation nature of the new value set, that's the reason we choose to go with the string builder. And again, cases where you think you don't have too many of new values. For example, you have three or two values, or even two values or three values, new values that are coming in, going with the string builder is not going to be again efficient, because string builder is a big class implementation of itself. And if you take a look at the string builder in the object browser, it has so many methods and so many functionalities available. So based on its implementation wise, this grows a very very big class, and using a string builder should have again a very good reason to go with. If it is like, if you have values like one or two values that you want to make use of it, and string is still good enough. Okay, you go with this only when you have a large collection of values that you want to handle. Okay, saying that, we are good with the string versus string builder. I'm going to take away that part. So we have covered that, and the other one is the class type. The class type is a very very basic thing, and we have seen this in the other slide. Again, in general, a class type is a data structure that may contain data members, function members, and also nested types. So data members, we'll see again about classes and their in other words, they are referred to as user defined data types in the subsequent session. And it can have constants and fields, and we'll see what is a constant, what is a field again. Function members like methods, properties, events, indexes, operators, instance constructors, destructors, static constructors, so on. So we have I'm going to have a session on complete types, completely on the constructors down the line. We'll see in detail about constructors and what is a methods, the properties, and other things. Don't worry. So ideally, classes are a special type of type, or in other words, user-defined data type, which can be used to create a complex complex data types, and it can also have a nested types within itself. That means a type within itself, like a class can have another class within itself. In other words, and class do support inheritance. And inheritance, probably you might know by now, and if at all you don't know, that's completely fine. We have a session on that covering the object-oriented programming principles. I try to put that information in the best way possible, so that I'm all these session topics that I'm trying to cover, I'm actually targeting those who are completely new. So if at all you already know all these topics, and then you might feel little slowness, but that slowness is deliberately done because to target those who are new and also have difficulty in understanding these topics. So so class can be created using a class keyword here, as we have seen in all of the demos that I'm doing here. They all have a class that's created in the console application. It is a must. And of course, in .NET, everything need to be inside a class. That's a very very important thing. Is everything that you do in .NET must be inside a class. It cannot sit outside a class. For example, what I mean to say here is I'm inside the namespace. Again, namespace we did cover, what is it. I'll say string str, oops, I'll say simply s. Okay, I'll simply say s. Oops. Okay, I'll say some value. Okay, so what's wrong with this statement here? So string s is equal to value, which is fine, but what is the compiler is trying to crib? Say it says a namespace cannot directly contain members such as fields or methods. So if you ever really want to have a method or a field created, everything must get into a class. It cannot sit outside a class. So if I bring the same line of code and put inside a class, then this is good. Only that it is giving a warning saying that it's not used. Otherwise, this is fine. I can still make, in other words, if I can make use of it inside this program, probably again it's going to creep saying that this is we are inside a static scope, and this is not inside a static scope. That's why this can crib. Again, what is a static, we'll see down the line. Okay, so don't worry about that. So so this statement is perfectly fine as long as I put it inside a class, and that's what I mean to say. Everything in .NET need to get into inside a class, like all these things that we had talked about, constants, fields, or methods, or properties, everything. Okay, and we have a special set of classes which we have walked through in the hierarchy diagram here. So these are kind of special classes which I have already walked through. One of them is a system.object. We know that this is an ultimate base class of all other types, including value types and reference types. And also a system.string. It's a string type of a C# it's a string type. In other words, a string is an alias for system.string in C#. System.value type, it is the base class of all value types. Okay, and again, this is a base class for all reference types. Enum is another very important thing which we're going to see quickly now. Let me try to create. Okay, we already have one class one here. I'm going to make use of this to create enum, and let's see what is an enum. Enum is again a special type. Again, I will say enum, and I have my enum here. Enum is a special type in which they can hold a set of values. If at all there is a case wherein you want to make use of a data type with predefined set of values, like in the case of a department I was talking about, enum say my department, I can actually do this way. I'll say IT and value to it. Again, the value is optional to me. I can even say IT, I'll say HR, and I can say what else I can think of, like markets, whatever. I can even put a here human resource, information. So this can be pretty well done, and I can build this up. And okay, because there is another main, I need to take that main off. Yep. So if you're wondering why this is happening again, as you know, this we are dealing with a console application, and console applications, as we know, that it starts with an entry point called a static void main. And we also demonstrated that it must be a main method because that's an entry point. In our previous session, we did see why it is. Main is a method which is an entry point where your console application, and you cannot have multiple entry points. That's the reason it's actually cribbing. And most of the time, it always scripts because of that. Then that's the reason. Even when you get this code downloaded from the SkyDrive and see, whenever you want to run the respective demo, always ensure that the rest of other codes are commented out, because of the respective main methods are commented out, and then you can make use of the class again. So in this case, I'm trying to demonstrate an enum and enumerated values, in wherein I, in this case, I have a my department, I have multiple set of values here, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to use that. So in this case, I'm going to take this off. You can actually use it in a wise way, but in this case, since I'm restricting this to a very quick demo, we're going to see a proper use of enums down the line, probably at the end of the training session in the projects. For now, what I'm going to do is I'll say my department dot human resource in this case, and also I'll say my department dot information t, or technology, what I meant to say. Okay, And so in cases where you have a predefined set of values, in those cases you can actually use enum, so that you can ensure, in other words, if you want to restrict in a drop-down values, for example, you want to make sure that you only allow these set of values to a given field, then you can actually create an enum and make that field of that data type. Then there's no way that people have to pick one of the value that you predefined in the enum. That's how we can actually make use of it. In the database terms, if you look at, it's another way, in database terms, it's the referential integrity that you're enforcing on a data field, wherein the respective department column refers to the department master data, or the reference data in a department reference data table. So in other words, in the programming way, this is using enums, you can enforce that in your data model. Okay, so good. And and what will be the output in this case? Okay, I'm just trying to read the output out, and I see that it's actually reading, just putting in the same thing. This is not a string that I passed, but it is an enum value, in other words, enumerated value to it. And if I really want to see is there any value attached to it? Okay, before I go to see the value that is attached to it, what type is it really is, enum is? If I take a go to definition and see, of course it's always going to come back on this. I'll go to my Object Explorer instead. Okay, let me hit this. Okay, so I see a member of course it's my own class. It doesn't tell you anything, but ideally speaking, enums are of a numeric type. Actually, so they are of type number. How is that? If I do typecast this, and by the way, this is how the typecasting is done in C#. If I want to convert this value to a different type, then this is how I need to do it. In this case, I'm trying to convert this value into an integer. Okay, so enums by default are integer types. So to just demonstrate that, so if you see the values that are being by default assigned to it is 0 and 1. 0 being the first one, information T and human resources and markets. It starts with the 0 and go on continue. That's a default behavior, but you can actually assign your own number there. I can say 100101. Imagine that these are the record ID or primary key IDs that you have in the database, in other words, and we are trying to use those here. Okay, I can see those values here. Okay, and in other words, I did say it's of a numeric type. That means any family, any integer type, like for example, by default it is integer. I can also make it as a long. Okay, this is also fine. But can I make it as a string? Let me see. I can keep my fingers crossed and see. No, you cannot. What it's expecting here, the error itself says it's expecting type byte, s byte, assigned byte, short, unsigned short, integer, unsigned integer, long, or unsigned long are expected. So it's a, by default, as I said, it's a number type, and it can take only a numeric value. But of course, it cannot take a float or a, you know, double or decimal, where you have precisions there. In this case, I'm going to leave the first one as is. Another simple and useful way to have enum is like I can define a range. That's one of the good example that I came across. Range, and I can say minimum is equal to say 10, and the maximum is equal to 50. So this is a very good use wherever you think you can. Like for example, age limit, right? You want to enforce an age limit wherein the you want to have data which is within this range, okay? And this can be enforced just like the other one that I have here. Of course, I'm going to override this. What I'm going to do is dot Oops, this is my department range dot minimum, and similarly range dot maximum. Okay, and of course I have to typecast this to integer, because otherwise I will normally see a min or max otherwise. Okay, to get the value for the respective range, I have to typecast those values into the integer data type. Similarly, if I really want to make this as a long, will this work? It should. If you see, although this my range is a long data type and I'm typecasting it to int, I'm able to see the value down. The reason, so this is called an implicit casting that happens between the data types. Normally, if you're trying to typecast a higher data range to a lower data range, there is no issue. It's going to do it implicitly because there is no loss of data. In other words, if you try to do with the small to higher, it should creep. That's my understanding. But if this is an integer, I will say integer. And I'm going to say long. Okay, will this be a problem? It doesn't problem. It's not at all a problem again. At runtime, no problem. The problem will come, the compiler is going to crib when you actually try to assign a larger value. In this case, I would like to put a max value for long. Okay, let me take, what is, how would I know that what is the max value of a long? I have console.writeline again. What I'm going to do is say integer dot say max value. So I would like to know the max value of an integer and then play with it. Okay, so in this case I have 2, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 digit number. Okay, what I'm going to do here is okay, I'm going to put it other way around so that we can satisfy the upper to lower. Okay, this is the long value and the max is say 10 digit, right? 1, 2, I'll say 9, 8, 7, 5, 6, 4, 3, 2, 1, and I'll add 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and build this, and now it started cribbing. If you see that, so if I try, this is a longer one, and longer one conversion is fine, but if I try to convert a long value, because this value is actually exceeding the max value of an integer, so it's going to crib. If I change the value, which is fine, so this is going to be done implicitly, and if the value is outside its reach, it's going to crib. Since this is at a design time, this is fine because I can noticeably see that it's going to break. What if you're trying to do the same thing with the runtime one? So this value might be coming from some external source and you try to use it this way, so it's going to break at runtime. So that's again a caution note that you need to keep in mind when you do with this kind of up higher data types to lower data types, which will be done implicitly, but you might likely get into a logical errors down the line. Okay, that's been said, and yes, that's about the enums. And similarly, arrays, we have a separate session completely for arrays. We'll see that, and delegate similarly, and exceptions also when we do with the exception handling. So these are some of the predefined class types that are very special in C#.NET. And these are the literals again. So literals are again, in other words, these are the way the values can be represented in the language. In other words, those are called literals. How this help is if you want to represent a value of a floating type value, how we can represent in the code, that's how the literals all stands for, and we'll see one by one. Okay, we have these high level literal types. One is a boolean, wherein the values of a boolean type can be true or false. That's of course obvious anyway, so nothing to do with that. And you can simply, I will go one by one actually. Have a code sample written for that. I'm going to take this off. We did cover the enums part. Literals, okay. Oh, I see there's one more class here. Okay, anyway, doesn't matter. We did cover the enums there. Okay, so these are the set of literals and various things that I was trying to show. And Boolean literal, it's simply true and false, and that's how the Boolean values can be referred to. And again, as we see, this is a BOOL is the bool, is the C-sharp alias for system.boolean, okay, .NET type. Both are same, so there's no difference. And we're trying to, of course, needless to, we can go one by one also to keep it simple and instead of jumping. Of course, when you run the Boolean value, it's going to see the true and false as an output, and for Boolean literals, the true and false are the two values inside the literals. It's going to be more interesting when we go with these strings. Definitely, I hope you'll see something new today. And with respect to the integer types, so integer types, how can you represent values? So for integer types, I'll take a close look at this. By default, if you assign any value without any decimals, that becomes an integer. That's the literal in which you do it. And if at all you're trying to do an unsigned int, you are intended to assign an unsigned integer to an, of course, uint data type, then you can specify with the capital U as a suffix or a small u. Either way, it's fine. But the recommended way is to use a capital U for the reason being, in this case, if you see is for long, L is the literal that you can use to give the value that it's the long value that you're assigning it. Ideally, do you really need to use this? Definitely not. In most of the cases, you don't have to really use this literals. But in case, because of the nature of these values that you're assigning, intend to do any implicit casting, the way we see that if you try to cast the higher range data type to a lower ones, instead of doing implicit casting and other things, you can actually specify those values to limit to that data type that you're referring to. In this case, L, capital L, going to be used for the long, and a small L, similarly, you can also make use of a small L. The reason why the capital is the preferred way to do it, because of the confusion normally. If you say 1 versus L, you hardly can really make a differentiate between them. So readability's sake, capital is the most preferred one as a best practice. And a couple of code analysis tools like StyleCorp, there's one other tool. If you run them, then by default the rule set normally looks for a capital L for these literals. So you can of course suppress them manually. And similarly for unsigned long, UL, it's a U, capital U and capital L, or small U and small L. So these are the literals for integers. So I assign the values there, I'm trying to print that out. And I see the values all are 10s, and of course their respective data types, like int32, uint32, and int64, uint64, so on. Okay, so I'm going to go a little fast, okay? And again, I can come down in the next topic. The intention, okay, fine. And these are the literals for real types, which means the float or the double or this decimal, which has the precisions, decimal points that you can add up. For float, simple, F, and for double it's D, capital D or small d, in case float, capital F or small f. A decimal, it's M, because you already have a D used in double. The next syllable in decimal is M, that's why M is chosen to be the literal for decimal type values. And if I run this quickly, it's the same output, all are 10s. Okay, good. So that's the real, of course, I think the valid value in this case should be like 10 with some decimals, otherwise really it's an integer, right? This should be the valid example for floating type or decimal type. For, of course, for integer types, this will not be applicable, right? It should crib if you try to assign a decimal value to these. Let me quickly go back and do that and see. Of course, it's definitely will crib. I'll say 25, build it. Expecting semicolon where. Okay, so it's not recognizing that as a valid literal at all together, because it's trying to expect an integer value. So it's completely a syntax error. It's trying to make it out. And in this case, of course, in the first place, you cannot actually assign implicit. It's treating that value as a double value, which cannot happen. Okay, for integers will not have a precision points. That's by default, everyone know. Okay, cool. That's done. And what else we have? We are done with the character literals. So this is an interesting one. Okay, I'm going to take up to this part. The character literals, as we have seen in one of the other example, so these are the, of course, by default, the character literal will actually start with the single quotes. You can actually give it the single quote values between that, and of course you can run this, and within the single quote value you can assign a single character, again not a multiple characters. If I say CAT, will this fly? No, there's too many characters, in character literal, so that's what it's saying. So you can, it can take only the, so as I said, the single quotes is the character literal, in other words. Or if you want to make it as a string, you can actually also make it this way. But this is again a different error saying that implicit conversion of type string to character not possible. Okay, and what if I do with only double quotes and C? For character, this is again, it cannot implicitly convert type string to char. So although char takes only a single character, you cannot actually put them into double quotes. So that's the one thing. So that's the way. Single quotes is a valid literal for character, and also you can it can take only one character within it. And as we know that this character data type takes 2 bytes memory. Why? Because this is by default a Unicode character. It can take any character set in the world, any languages you're talking about. It can take Chinese, Japanese, or any language set you choose. It's culture neutral. You can make it. It can code any language. In other words, so that's why it's 2 bytes, and it can accommodate, of course, all those things. And that's about the character. And of course, this is another thing, another important thing is the escape sequences. We did make use of these escape sequences in the other session, in other example that we just ran, wherein we used the newland character and the tabbed. And in this case, we are using the single quotes. Within the string, if I want to show a single quote, then you can make use of the, let me expand this. So this is the single quote literal. In other words, the literals or sequence or escape sequence normally starts with a backslash followed by a character. If at all you want to show a single quote within your text, then you can actually make use of the these escape sequences. And in this case, it's a double quotes. So you want to show a text with a double quotes, since if you understand, within the string literal itself is a double quotes, and within that you want to show have a double quotes, then it's not going to be possible. In which case, you can make use of the literals, because otherwise, by syntax wise, you cannot show a double quotes directly within a string. You have to use the escape sequence to do that. And similarly, the backslash T is for tab delimitation, and which is a horizontal tab, and there is something called V for vertical tab, and backslash backslash for backslash, and B for backspace. That means the output should take this space off and print. And this is a new line, last one. Let me run this and see. Excuse me. And that's the output we have here with the in the single quotes case, we have the single quotes written out, and also in the double quotes string letter, we have the double quotes written out. And this is a tab, where is this? This is a horizontal tab that's added up, and backslash, if you want to have a backslash added up here, and of course backspace slash B, which is taken off the space that I have here. And the new line character, that means the hello is in the first line and the world is in the second line. So that's how the escape sequences can be made use in the string literals. Okay, this is again a very useful thing, especially when you are actually writing text to a flat file. In that case, the literals are very, very useful. Well, especially the escape sequence I'm talking about. Okay, the last one, but not the least one, the string literals. Again, as we see, this is the standard string literal. We have seen this a lot many times, so using the double quotes is the what we're going to value representing a string value. And another important thing here is the string literals are of two types. One is the regular string literal, in which case it's double quotes and any number of characters between that. And whereas another one is called a verbatim. The verbatim string literals normally don't process any of the escape sequences that you have. In the earlier example with respect to character escape sequences, we did see that the quotes means something, right? You want to have these quotes available. If you use this in the default way, you're going to actually these escape sequences are transformed into a different output. In this case, backslash is gone, only the quote is displayed outside. When you use, of course, another one step back, right, to how you represent a verbatim. Verbatims are represented using an at the rate symbol before the string. So this indicates that you're using a verbatim literal at the rate followed by double quotes and the string any number of characters within this, and then closed within the double quotes. That's the literal for verbatim string literal. What this will do is it's not going to process any of these escape sequences. So what it means is whatever value you give within this text as a regular string literal with the verbatim literal, it's going to give you the same way word to word. That's what the verbatim means. Verbatim means the word to word. It's going to just give you what you have inside it without any issues. Okay, it will not process them to spit out as a separate values like in the case of escape sequences. So the output, if you see, let me take a close look at this. Yeah, so in this case, without the verbatim literal, what we have seen here is the quotes. The escape sequence is processed to emit out with the single quotes. In the second case, it's actually written out as is. So it's a verbatim literal. Similarly for the hello world. Okay, so with the backslash T, which is your escape sequence, in this case, the escape sequence is processed to give you a tab space there. And that's about the character literals and the string literals. This is supposed to be string. Okay. So this is taken. The last one is the null. So null literal, again, it's of course the default values for a object is a null implicitly, And if you want to assign anything, any value type, sorry, reference types, then you can assign them to a null. Again, null you can't use with the value types. For example, string, okay, string is equal to null. If I do, string is of course a reference type, it shouldn't crib actually. Let me see. So this is just a warning that it is saying the value, the variable is not used. Yeah, so otherwise this is a valid statement because string is a reference type. If I do int, int is a value type, I cannot use it. What it's trying to do here is cannot convert null to integer because it is a non-nullable. Again, non-nullable, nullable types are different. In this context, null is a literal for reference types, not for the value types, to initialize them to nothing, in other words. Okay. We will definitely walk through what's a nullable type in detail, actually. In the, down the line, we'll have a very good sessions which will talk about nullable types, which is the feature that's added up in framework 2.0, 3.0. Okay, good. And in this case, of course, if I run this code, you will see nothing because it's assigned to null. And of course, you don't see anything. The type is the value that actually tried to put that out. Okay, that's about the literals. And this will take to the end of the session. Okay, so in this session 6, we did walk through the computer memory basics, so what is a bit, what is a byte, all the memory units, and we did deep dive into the flip-flops and latches inside the hardware part of the memory management. So we did walk through why 8 bits in a byte and the code page referring to all the 256 character set, which is the reason why we have 8 bits in a given architecture. And we did see what's the character sets and different types of character sets available out there in the market. And we walked through what is a value type and a reference type in general. So data types basics we did walk through, what are the different dimensions for a value type and for an object. Okay, and also we did walk through different type categories in .NET, which is a value type, a reference type, and a pointer type. And the type categories, we did continue with a deep dive into a value type, how the memory is managed for value types, which is in stack, and also the heap for reference types. And we did see how can we instantiate the members, like creating an object and for reference type and as well as for value type. And continuing with the type categories, we did see what is a mutable nature and the mutable nature of the reference type and value types with a very good code example. And we did see what is a boxing and unboxing with a very good demo. And we did see the C#.NET data types tree of all the predefined data types in general and their classification. And we did see all the primitive types chart showcasing all the data types comparing to VB.NET and C#.NET and their dimensions and the value range in general. And also this is a continuation to the same set. And finally, we did deep dive into what a system.object contains, and it has a four set of methods available. And key thing to note here is that the object doesn't have any properties with it. So in interviews you might ask how many properties you have for an object, but yeah, keep in mind there are no properties for objects. You have only methods within it. Okay. So and also we did see the data type hierarchy. An interesting to point here is that system.valueType also inherits from system.object. And a class type. And we did walk through what is a class type. And we did see C# data type alias. All the alias keywords we've seen in C#, we did walk through mapping to the .NET types. And we did see a string versus string builder. and C# literals. We did walk through the Boolean literal, integer literals, real literals, character literals, string literals, and null literals. And with that, we continue with our next topics in the next session.